And you can begin. Thank you.
Thanks. Okay, so thanks for the invitation and for the possibility to give a talk. So as you see indeed from the title, we talk about some analytical results or office field approach, let's say, on topology optimization, actually linearized elastoplasticity. And okay, and what I will talk about is a result obtained in collaboration with Ulisse Stefanelli. Okay, so even if this was already said also during the already in the past days during the conference, so let's see just a brief introduction about topology optimization. So this is by now let's say a typical tool in also in industrial design, and it aims to the aim is to detect an optimal distribution of, let's say, a certain material, a known material actually, inside a design region, let's say, which is here a fixed region of omega in Rn, and in the picture is just the square in R2, of course. And okay, the data of the problem are usually the applied forces. So you know the force F, which is a volume force. Then you have possible traction on a part of the boundary of omega. So here denoted by gamma N, and the traction is here G. And then you may assume also that you have some boundary data. So let's say boundary Dirichlet condition, W on gamma D, which is again a subset of omega. And what we want to detect is here the blue set, light blue set E, which is basically the set where the material, will be distributed. And what you want to do is somehow to maximize the performance of the resulting object. Let's say maximizing the response, for instance, to the applied forces. And okay, so of course I'm saying that I want to maximize something, so to optimize something. So of course this calls for mathematical terms for an optimal control problem, in which I say that the control parameter is, which is also the unknown of the problem, of course, is the set E, which will be filled, let's say, with the material. And okay, and then we are assuming that we know everything about the material that will be then distributed in omega. So which means that we know its physical properties. And so basically the physics of the material will enter in the problem as a constraint, the constraint of the for the optimal problem, for the optimal control problem. And okay, in general, of course, you can talk about equilibrium condition if you have an equilibrium problem, or in what should be usual, typical, let's say, in elastoplasticity is actually an evolution equation, an evolution problem. Okay, nevertheless, we are actually starting from an equilibrium problem. And actually we start from what I would call a sharp interface problem, or a sharp problem in general. So what does it mean? Basically, you want to detect this set E, and now set is just identified with the level set of a certain function, of a scalar function Z, that takes only the values 0 and 1. And so Z equal to 1, it means that we are seeing the body, so it's the body that we want to identify, while Z equal to 0 is the void region. Or actually, in our case, from general mathematical reason, if you want, we have this sort of ersatz material assumption, which means that the void is not actually void, but we assume that there is a certain material that is anyway, let's say, very compliant. So the stiffness, the elasticity tensor is very small, and also the hardening tensor will be very small. So let's say the contribution to the energy or to the problem is in general very, very, very small. Okay, so we consider the model of linearized elastoplasticity with hardening, actually kinematic hardening. So it means that if U is the displacement living in omega, we have the usual assumption of small strain. So the total strain is here denoted by U of U, is a symmetric part of the gradient of U, is decomposed into the usual elastic and plastic strain, so epsilon and P respectively. And we define the energy. So, okay, the internal energy is just the sum of the elastic and the plastic part, where C is the elasticity tensor, H is the hardening tensor. And again, according to the hypothesis of ersatz material, we are assuming that CNH above positive definite, actually bounded away from zero, let's say. So here is uniformly with respect to Z in the interval 0, 1. So basically we are already preparing the hypothesis for the phase field model. And okay, so here you see that in the void region, you would have actually CNH equals zero, while with this ersatz material, you can assume that you are never singular in the wool of omega and with respect to all Z in the interval. And finally, since it is an elastoplasticity model, we have to consider a normality rule, which is here the von Mises criterion. And so the thermodynamic force, which is associated to P, to the strain P, is now has to lay in the subdifferential of the modulus of P. And here D of Z is the yield stress. And again, it is positive uniformly with respect to Z. So it is again this ersatz material assumption. And okay, here you see, usually you would see in elastoplasticity an evolution problem where here you would have P dot actually. And as I said before, we start from an equilibrium problem. So P dot is, so here we assume we consider only P. And let's say from a physical point of view, the equilibrium problem has no real meaning, but let's say it is meaningful from a mathematical point of view. Because let's say if you want to approximate a solution or if you want to simulate something in general, even if you will not see any simulation, what you usually do is to, let's say, discretize in time. And then at every time step, you solve an equilibrium problem, basically. So let's say to understand how topology optimization in elastoplasticity works, it is useful to start from an equilibrium problem if you want an incremental problem, a time incremental problem. And then see at the very end, we will see at the very end how it works for, or what we could say for the evolution problem. Okay, so this said, we introduce, let's say, the data of the problem, which are as in the picture at the very beginning, the applied forces, so the volume forces F, and the traction G, living on gamma N, and then this boundary datum W, so Dirichlet boundary datum. So the assumption are, okay, very mild, so L2, L2, and H1, so some mobility and nothing more. We give, let's say we state our problem in the primal formulation or strain formulation, so everything will be given in terms of the displacement and the elastic and plastic strain, satisfying the boundary datum, and as I said before, the additive splitting on the strain, of the strain. So the target function we consider is just, so the following is the sum of basically two main terms. So you have these two integrals here that are just representing the compliance. And here in particular, you see the volume force F is pre-multiplied by a function L that you may think just as the identity. So since Z takes values takes only the values 0, 1, what we are assuming in general is that, for instance, L takes the value 1, where Z is equal 1, and 0, where Z equals 0. But this is already to prepare the, let's say, the setting, the phase field setting, where L is actually interpolating, let's say, between 0 and 1. So this means that in the cost functional, we only consider the force, the volume forces apply, let's say, on the body that we want to identify somehow. And then the last term is the perimeter of the set, let's say, of the body to be identified. So perimeter means the measure of the boundary. And this is a good term from a mathematical and also physical point of view, since basically it is avoiding it avoids microstructure. Basically with microstructures, you would produce something with a very small volume, but a very large perimeter. And so in this way, you just try to avoid some microstructures or too many oscillations, let's say. Okay, so as I said, we at the end of the day, we want to minimize this functional here, the target functional J, under the equilibrium condition for elastoplasticity, which are given in terms of here, in terms of our minimum problem. So we want to minimize some energy functional. So the energy is defined as, let's say, the internal energy. So you have elasticity, elastic, plastic energy, or hardening part, let's say, and the work of external forces. And then you define the dissipation functional, which is related to the Fermi's criterion. So it's just the L1 norm multiplied by the stress. Okay, so now that you have all the ingredients for your problem, you just define the topology optimization problem for linearized elastoplasticity, which means that you want to minimize the functional J. Oops. let's say on the functions Z that are in BV and take only values in 0, 1. So being in BV means basically that this perimeter is finite. And as I said before, we have then a restriction, a constraint, or if you want, the forward problem in terms of optimal control, which means that the displacement U here has to be a solution of the equilibrium problem for elastoplasticity, which, as I said before, is expressed in terms of a minimum problem. So you minimize the energy plus the dissipation. Okay, so for this problem, you have a solution. This is quite easy to see. You do it with the direct method of the calculus of variation. And the main problem is that now you would like to say something about the first order optimality conditions. So this is also a natural question in optimal control. And the problem here is that you have, of course, a geometric singularity, which is the set of Barney perimeter, which is, okay, can be handled, but it's kind of difficult, let's say. And this has to be coupled then with plasticity. And let's say up to now, we did not really understand how to do it. But let's say you have a trick, which is to somehow approximate this problem and then work with an approximate problem, or if you want, somehow a relaxed problem, which is indeed the phase field approximation. So what you do, instead of considering only functions with a value that take value in 0 and 1, so only the value 0, 1, you assume now the function Z to take values in the Woolly interval 0, 1. So you have a sort of convexification of the problem. And okay, so basically what you're saying is that where the function Z is very close, you may assume that you have your, let's say, the body that you want to identify. When Z is very close to zero, you have the void, or let's say the hazard material. And then you are allowing for some gray level, which is basically the area, the level set, or let's say the set where Z is far from zero and far from one somehow. So of course you want to penalize this area. Okay, and how you do it? You do it through the target functional. So you fix a small parameter delta. The target functional is basically somehow the same as before. So you have here the compliance, which has not changed. Simply Z is now in H1 and takes values in 0, 1. And then you have this new term, which is, if you want, a modicum ortholog term. And this is an approximation of the perimeter at the end of the day, in the sense that, let's say, you have to imagine that delta is very small. So in this double well potential, you see that Z is forced to be very close to either very close to zero or very close to one in large part of the domain. Transitions between the two phases are allowed, but you're paying them with the gradient. So you cannot have too many transitions, so too many oscillations, as with the perimeter, let's say. And these transitions are delta small in general. And so you may imagine that when delta goes to zero, you are approximating the perimeter. Okay, so the energy functions instead are the same. So you can set up a phase field optimality, phase field topology optimization problem. So you want to minimize now J delta with respect to Z. Then you have also appearing the displacement, but the displacement is subjected again to this let's say, equilibrium problem. So it has to be the solution again of the physics, so of the equilibrium problem for elastoplasticity. And okay, I didn't notice it this before, but actually U is uniquely determined. So the solution of this minimum problem is unique. So at the end of the day, the functional J delta here depends only on Z. And as before, also in the sharp problem, it was also depending only on the function z. So also here you can say that you have a solution. So for every delta, actually, there exists a solution. The hypotheses are exactly the same. And what is important is that if you take a sequence of solutions at delta, for delta tends it going to zero, then let's say up to subsequence, you converge to a solution z of the original problem. So the sharp problem. And this is actually a result in gamma convergence. So there is, let's say, the problem, you can say the problem P delta is actually gamma convergent to the sharp problem. And so you have also convergence of solution. Okay, but now let's say for this problem, we have some hope to find optimality conditions, since let's say the functional J delta is actually super regular. Okay, it's smooth, at least differentiable. There is still one problem, that is the dissipation here. So the dissipation, you have only an L1 norm of the strain, and the L1 norm is not, so let's say the norm of the strain is not differentiable. So what you do to obtain optimality conditions is actually to first approximate this problem again, the phase field problem. So you regularize actually the problem. You find the the optimality condition for the regularized problem, and then you pass to the limit in the regularization. Okay, so this is what we do now. So let's say if gamma is our, let's say, regularization parameter, you substitute the norm of P with this function here, that of course is not a norm anymore, but at least it is smooth. It is actually is infinity and strictly convex. And okay, so you redefine your, you define a regularized dissipation. Simply, as I said, you substitute the modulus of the strain with this H gamma of P. And now you set up the problem, this approximate problem for gamma and delta fixed. Basically, you again minimize the same function as before with delta fixed, as I said, with respect to the phase field. And this is again subjected to, let's say, the equilibrium problem now, or the minimization of the sum of energy plus this regularized dissipation. So this is not anymore a physical problem, let's say. It's not anymore elastoplasticity, but it's a regularization of elastoplasticity. This appeared also in other papers, in, let's say, control in elastoplasticity, actually traction control problems. Okay, and again, if you think that the delta is fixed, this problem emits a solution, again, not unique. But if you take a sequence of solutions at gamma and you let gamma go to infinity, then z gamma is converging to a solution of the original phase field problem. This is true also for every delta. Okay, so now in this problem instead, P gamma delta, everything is smooth. So we can compute actually first order optimality condition. And the only missing point is that we have to prove that the control to state operator is Fréchet differentiable. And this is again, typical in optic quantum control problems. So what is the control to state operator? It's simply the function that associates to a phase field. Here is a general function at infinity. Let's say the state, the solution of the equilibrium problem. So here there is the arg mean of the energy plus the regularized dissipation in the class of admissible triples, again, that are satisfying the boundary datum and the splitting of the strain. Okay, so we have to prove that this is differentiable. Well, this is quite clear. Let's say that if the Z gamma is a solution of our optimization problem, then the optimality condition is given by differentiating in a direction, and this derivative has to be equal to zero. So of course, when you compute this derivative, at a certain point, you have to compute the derivative of S gamma. So you need this to be Fréchet differentiable. And this can be obtained. Let's say is the most technical part of the result. But to ensure the differentiability, let's say you have to pay a bit on the regularity of the data. So here you have to assume that F, G, and W are actually slightly better than L2 or H1. H1, they are actually P summable for P slightly larger than 2. So whatever P larger than 2 is okay. And with this hypothesis, you can prove that for every gamma, S gamma is Fréchet differentiable. And now it, you introduce simply this notation. So u gamma epsilon gamma p gamma is s gamma of z. So is the state related to the phase field z. Then given a direction phi, the derivative of s gamma computed in z in the direction phi is here denoted by this guy. So it's again a tripole with zero boundary condition. And it's satisfying a sort of variational PD that can be written actually also as a minimum problem. And here somehow it is clear why we have to regularize the problem. So on one side, you have the gradient of H gamma appearing. So before with the norm of P, we cannot do it. So we would have only the subdifferential of P. And on the other hand, we also have the Hessian of gamma, the Hessian of H, which we could not compute if we have only the norm of P, let's say, in the problem. Okay, so here there is still one detail to fix, which is that, let's say, this tripod would be already enough to compute this derivative. The problem is that you would have a dependence of phi on phi in this derivative that is hidden inside here. And this is quite complicated, actually. Let's say is a bit implicit. So what you want to see is actually dependence on phi more explicit and simpler. And so what you do is, again, let's say a typical step, I would say, in optimal control, which is to compute an adjoint system, or if you want, some adjoint variables. And this is indeed what we do in this corollary. So let's say we introduce the adjoint variables u bar gamma, epsilon bar gamma, and p bar gamma, which are again of elastoplastic type, let's say, and with zero boundary condition. And they are now characterized by this first equation here, which is again can be written also in terms of a minimum problem. So it is uniquely determined, actually. And okay, and here you see that there is no phi anymore appearing. And now the second equation is actually the real optimality condition somehow, is what you obtain when you differentiate the target functional in the minimum. Okay, and the equation that you obtain is the following one. So something equals zero. So it's just the derivative at the end of the day of the, how you call them, of the forces, let's say, the compliance. And this is the derivative instead of the modicum orthogonal function. Okay. And as you see, you have phi appearing only explicitly, while you don't have an implicit dependence of phi on the adjoint variables. Okay, so now we can pass to the limit as gamma tends to plus infinity. This is done in the following theorem. Again, the same hypothesis, of course. So p larger than 2, and you have a better summability of f, g, and w. You take a sequence at gamma of solutions. Here, delta is fixed, as I said before. You pass to the limit in gamma. So z converges to some solution, z gamma, sorry, converges to some solution z of the phase field problem. And the same does the state variable. Let's say u gamma epsilon gamma p gamma is actually converging to u epsilon p. So here, the first two equations are actually simply a reformulation of the equilibrium condition. So this is nothing new. We are writing the equilibrium condition in terms of this field row that is anyway living in the subdifferential of the modulus of P. Okay, so up to here, nothing new. But then we have this set of optimality conditions that are expressed in terms of the adjoint variables, let's say u bar, epsilon bar, p bar. And there is another adjoint variable pi that is living in L2 and with values in the, let's say, in the deviatoric matrices. Okay, so how they are related? Well, this first equation is basically equivalent to, in the case gamma finite, is equivalent to this function here. Of course, in gamma to, when gamma goes to plus infinity, we don't have any more the Hessian at our disposal. And that's why pi appears here, this additional field pi. Then the second equation is again, let's say the, loosely speaking, is the derivative of the target functional, where here you have rho instead of the gradient of h, let's say. And finally, let's say, we said before that, so we have this additional field pi, that is a bit strange, let's say, to characterize, but on the other hand, it is not completely random in space, in the sense that it has to satisfy some conditions. So in particular, some complementarity conditions. So in particular, it is orthogonal to P almost everywhere in omega. P times pi P bar is positive. And then P bar is also, let's say, behaving more or less as P in the sense that P bar is equal zero, where rho is smaller than D of Z. And this is what happens also for P, actually. Okay, so just a sketch of the proof, actually, just to understand what is what here. So as I said before, for the regularized problem, we have the gradient and the Hessian of gamma of H gamma at our disposal. So you may redefine rho gamma as the in terms of the gradient of H and this additional field pi gamma in terms of the Hessian of H. And you can rewrite then the optimality conditions in terms of rho and rho gamma and pi gamma in the following form. And so as you see, basically these two equations are already in the same form as in the theorem. So basically what you do is just pass the limit as gamma tends to plus infinity. You ensure that all the convergences are good, let's say. And what you obtain in the end is, are exactly the optimality condition. So this is actually not important. Okay, so now that we found the, let's say a result, the optimality conditions for the equilibrium problem, I will try to convince you that it is possible to do the same also for the evolution problem. Indeed, passing through, let's say, the analysis that we did for the static problem. Okay, so in the evolution problem, let's say given your data, actually here G and W are assumed to be zero. Let's say and given a phase field Z, what you can do basically the elastoplastic evolution is characterized by this system. So you have simply equilibrium of forces, the von Mises criterion, so the von Mises flow rule, and then again the boundary datum. So just for simplicity, as I said, the Riesz-Brown boundary datum is zero and the traction is equal to zero on gamma n. Okay, so the solution to this system is known to be unique for every Z. But in particular, there is a way to characterize, let's say, this equation that is this solution that is also, that is a so-called energetic formulation that in general you can find in the theory of rate-independent systems. And what you do is you express this system in terms of an equilibrium that here is denoted by S and an energy balance. So the equilibrium is simply saying that for every time you have to solve an equilibrium problem, indeed. So actually is a minimization problem here. And then the energy balance is saying that the energy at time t plus the dissipation, the total plus the dissipation is equal to, let's say, the work done by an external forces. So here you only have the volume forces F. Here you would have also, you should have also the initial energy, but again, we are assuming also that the initial condition is equal zero. So let's say everything is equal to zero at the beginning, at time zero. Okay, so of course you can set up your topology optimization problem also in the evolution setting. So let's say you redefine your functional J, your target functional, still depending on the phase field Z and on the displacement U that now is actually a function of T. So here you see the last term is the same as before. So is a modicum modulo term. And then you have this generalization, let's say, of the compliance. So it's a sort of evolutive compliance. I don't know how to call it. So let's say is counting the force at time t And then you have, let's say, the energy that is spent during the evolution. That is the same term appearing actually in the energy balance. Okay, so you want to minimize your functional with respect to Z under the condition that U epsilon P is a solution, so is an evolution, elastoplastic evolution. And actually, again, in this setting, this tripod here is unique for every Z. So what you can say at the end of the day is that J delta is only a function of U, is only a function of Z, again, since U is uniquely determined by Z. Okay, so of course this problem admits again a solution, but you want to find the optimality condition. And so what you do, well, there is a way to, in general, to approximate an evolution here. Let's say an elastoplastic evolution, which is to go by time discretization, as I mentioned before, at the very beginning. So basically, you discretize time, you find a discretization of your continuum force F, and you may define, let's say, the energy at discretized time. It's basically the same as before, so elastic part, plastic part, and the forces are now the discretized forces. Okay, so this given, you can, let's say, approximate an evolution by replacing, let's say, S and E, so the equilibrium and the energy balance, all in terms of an equilibrium problem, let's say an incremental equilibrium problem indeed, in which you minimize this energy plus the dissipation, where here you see, let's say in the first part of the talk, we had this dissipation in which this pKi minus one was actually set equal zero. So there was no previous plastic strain. Here, of course, we have to take into account the plastic strain appearing at the previous time. But at the end of the day, this problem is still an equilibrium problem. And so what you can believe is that you can, let's say, in general, set up a topology optimization problem, find the equilibrium condition for this problem here, so let's say actually for this problem here, and then pass to the limit in K and pass to the limit also in the first order optimality condition. So let's say, again, you set up your topology optimization problem in time discrete. So here JK delta means simply that you define your target functional that is considering only your discretized forces, but for the rest it has exactly the same form as J delta before. This problem meets a solution for every K, and basically you can do very long computations that are anyway based, let's say, on the first part of the talk, so on the computation that we did for the equilibrium problem. And what you end up with in the time continuum problem at the very end of the day is that you have the following optimality condition. So these two again are simply the equilibrium condition. So this is nothing new, this is everything known. The novelty is instead given by these four equations here. So basically we prove that there exists the following adjoint variables. So again, you have two new fields, let's say P0 bar and pi, where pi is basically the same as before, and pi now also depends on time. And then you have U bar, epsilon bar, P bar, again, depending on time, of course. But let's say for almost every T, you have this characterization or this relation between epsilon bar, P bar, let's say also U bar, okay, and pi of T. Then you have, this is the equivalent to the derivative of the target functional. Of course, it is integrated in time because the functional was integrated in time. And finally, let's say you have these two additional conditions. So this one, let's say in the equilibrium problem, if you remember, it was in the form pi times p equal to zero almost everywhere. So here now, of course, you have at your disposal pi p dot. And so the equation in evolution terms becomes p times p dot, equals 0 for almost every T and almost everywhere in omega. And finally, what you would like to see is also that, so if we, no, we cannot go back, so it's okay. So what you would like to see is also that P bar dot is equal to 0, well, where rho is smaller than D. So this you cannot achieve since, let's say, P bar in general is only an infinity, it has no derivatives, but this is, let's say, somehow a weak way to write it. And so it, you can interpret somehow P0 bar as the initial value of P bar. Okay, and so with this I conclude, and I thanks for your attention.
Thank you, Stefano.